I did an experiment once with some women. I was told they didn't like poetry, but nevertheless, I was invited to give a reading to them. And it was a club of Jewish women, a luncheon club. So I thought, well, how could I use this in an interesting way? So I took poems to them, all written by women, some by Arab women, some by Jewish women, some by Israelis, some by Palestinians. And I read them the poems, and then I would say, guess, who wrote that? And they got everyone wrong. And then we were, by the end of this session, 30 minutes, we were laughing, and they were saying, but they all sound similar, like they all care about the same things, or they all love olive trees, fig trees, their children. They all hope for peace, more peaceful days. They all sound the same. And I thought, okay, poetry has done its job. Because if people could just realize that our mutual desires and needs and concerns are very similar, it might get harder to keep those cycles of revenge and disrespect spinning on and on. Poems give us a kind of timeless, deeper moment of thinking, of connection, of image. When you think of a line from a poem, I often think of a line from Langston Hughes, "I can see your house, babe, but I can't see you." And I think about how all my life I wanted to see you as well, and so did he. Or a line from William Stafford, "There's a thread I follow." You know, I think for every poet, you have a thread of language on the page that helps you feel calmer just to follow it. You know, what are the verbs of this day that you have encountered? What are the nouns? How do they go together? How do we look at everything we've heard today and find a calmer place to consider it from? Otherwise, we're just battered about. So poetry has always tried to be, I think, a slightly deeper, loving look at whatever it's considering. You know, in a contemplative way, a long, loving look. I think poems do that too, even if the poem is crying out or experiencing anguish over something that's lost. It's out of love that it's crying.